Well, it's good to be in the house of the Lord, amen? And it's encouraging. I love the spirit in this room this morning. I love that we're about to talk about the things of God and the Word of God. I'd like you to turn to the book of 1 Corinthians for me. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We won't be there immediately, so stay with me. We'll come to it a little bit later in the message, but I want you to be prepared. I want you to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And I want you to get the big idea this morning, and it's in your notes, but before we review what the big idea is, I want to share a story with you. I like to hike and camp and do things on trails. How many of you guys like to hike and camp and do things outside and maybe go on a trail in North Georgia Mountains? Beautiful out there, right? Well, I remember a time ago when, I don't remember the exact trail, but I remember hiking on a trail, and I began to start to question where I was on the trail. I knew that the trail was a loop, but I thought I maybe had taken a wrong turn, right? Maybe I had veered off the trail somehow. And as I began to think about that, I began to get a little bit nervous, and the sun was going down, and it started to get dark, and I walked a little further, and still nothing, and still couldn't figure out if I was on the right trail. Finally, an idea came into my head that actually had come from me from Alaska when I lived in Alaska for a little while. I thought, you know what? In Alaska, they have these markers. They have a color-coded system. And sometimes on a tree, you'll see like a yellow dot, and it means you're on that trail. So I started to look for some type of system, some type of colors, and sure enough, pretty soon I found a red dot. And I saw that red dot and I thought, okay, now I just gotta find the next red dot because I knew that the trail looped. I knew it'd eventually bring me back to where I initially started and bring me ultimately home. So I continued to follow and follow, and after about four or five trees with the red dot, I saw a light in the distance and I knew, thank goodness, it was dark. I thought maybe a bear was chasing me. I didn't know what was going on. You know how your mind starts to play tricks on you, right? In that type of situation. I made it to my end destination. I made it safely and securely, and it made me think about what we're talking about today. We're continuing this series called Finding Contentment. And the big idea that I want you to know this morning, it's in your notes if you'll look at it. As I read it aloud, I want you to go away with this if you go away with nothing else. The big idea is simply, if I want to find contentment, I must walk in God's will. Just like on that path, if I wanted to make it to my destination, I had to walk the right path. In your life, God has a specific will for you. Some of you think, well, I already know what the will is. You know, I'm doing it. I'm right here. I'm doing this job, and I've got my family, and I've got my life situation. But maybe God wants you to take a little bit of a right turn or maybe a little bit of a left turn. But it's important to know that you're in the will of God because that's where happiness comes from. That's where contentment comes from. Peace comes from, security, all those things. Knowing you're directly smack dab in the middle of God's will. Do you want to be in the center of God's will this morning? Would you say amen?
Amen.
We all should desire that. So I want to give you five guideposts this morning. Five guideposts to walk in God's wills. Just like those trees were there with those dots, you can know these guideposts, go back to them, refer to them, look at them, and know if this is God's will for your life. Are you facing a decision? Are you facing certain circumstances? Are you going through something in your life where you would like to know God's will? Maybe you just want to know the overall direction. Follow these five guideposts and you will be in the center of God's will and you will find contentment for your life. Would you go with me to the Lord in prayer? Let's bow. Father, I pray that you would speak through me this morning, that your spirit would have free will, that you would be glorified. Lord, I pray that your word would just simply pierce the heart of every single person here. Help us to hear not only with our ears, Lord, but with our hearts, with our minds, with our souls. Help us to take this teaching, to embed it into our life, to make it a part of who we are so that we will find your will and in so doing find contentment. Be praised this morning. Be glorified this morning. Be exalted through your word this morning. Lord, help someone here that doesn't know you. Help them to come to know you, Lord. Help them to know that you love them and that your will for them is that they come to know you, the one true God. We love you. We praise you. Be with us now. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. The first guidepost that I want to talk to you about this morning is that you would walk in God's word. Many of you have heard this many, many times. and it's easy to turn this off. But if you're going to walk in God's will, you must walk in God's word. John 17, 17 says, sanctify them by truth. This is Jesus speaking. He says, sanctify them by the truth. And then he says this, your word is truth. Amen? If you want to know what direction to go, you have to have the proper guide map. You have to have the right direction, the right compass, and the word of God is just that. Let me ask you this morning. Are there black and white commands in Scripture? Absolutely there are. There are things that the Scripture say, thou shalt not, right? And things that the Scripture say to go ahead and do this. And so when we talk about being in God's will and walking in God's word, we have to understand if it's against the word of God, are you listening? Say amen. Amen. If it's against the word of God, it's not the will of God. Period. Someone once wondered if they were married to the right person. There's an indication for that. It's called the marriage certificate. You look on that, you see who it is, and you know you're married to the right person. Amen? You see, the word of God will not contradict God himself. And if you want to know the will of God in your life, it's as simple as picking up the word of God, studying the word of God, asking about the word of God, seeking out biblical counselors about the word of God. God will never lead you down a path that is contrary to his word. Amen? Someone was thinking about quitting their job, going off, doing something different, leaving their family, and they just said, and this was a real experience that I experienced many, many years ago, actually when I was a teenager. And this guy was in the church. He was kind of a steadfast person in the church, had a family. He said, I believe God's just called me to quit my job and just to go and start this new venture. And I'm not going to be really able to do the things that I know I probably should do, but I know God has spoken to me. I know God has spoken to me. He told me to do this one thing. Listen, God wants you to be a provider, gentlemen, husbands. So what God is telling you clearly from his scriptures is to provide for your family first and foremost. God's not going to give you an ambition, a dream, a goal that is so far out there that you have to neglect your basic responsibilities in the word of God. Amen? If it's against the word of God, it's not the will of God. We talked about this verse this morning, Psalm 119, 105, a scripture many of you have memorized. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light unto my path. Man, how cool would it have been to have a bunch of lights out there in that dark? I only had one little flashlight, the little headlamp. You guys know what I'm talking about? And I was able to shine that headlamp on the trees to see those dots, and I was able to see the roots that were big and overgrown in the rocks, and if there was a bear coming out, I was able to see the bear in front of me. It never happened, thank God. But the word of God is like that in your life. It's a light to shine truth on everything in your life, to shine truth on the will of God in your life, to shine the truth in the situations that you're encountering. The first question that you need to ask, believer, is, am I walking in God's word? If it's against the word of God, you're not in. Ooh, that was weak. If it's against the word of God, you're not in the. One more time for all that you have within you, all right? I want to hear your Sunday morning football screaming voice. If it's against the word of God, it's not the. I like it. Good job. Let's move on. Number two, walk in God's work. I had to articulate that, right? So you didn't think it was repeated. Walk in God's work. Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 10 says this, for we are his workmanship. You guys remember this? We just talked about this a couple weeks ago. For we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for, say it with me, good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them. Also, Titus, 2nd chapter, verse 14 says this, who gave himself, speaking of Jesus, for us to redeem us from every lawless deed and to purify for himself a people for his own possession, zealous for good deeds. You see, God's desire for your life is good works, good deeds. He didn't just save you from something. You see, many people think that God saved you just from hell, and he did. Hallelujah. If you've trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior, God has saved you from eternal separation from him in a place called hell. If you've placed your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, believed that he died on the cross, repented from your sin, accepted him as Lord and Savior, you have a new home in heaven and a new relationship with God. Amen? But what we fail to understand sometimes is he didn't just save us from something, he saved us to something. He didn't just save us from something, he saved us for something. You were created for good works. Not just your job. Not just your own pleasures. Not just your own desires. Amen? You were created for a purpose, for something. Many people look at salvation as just a get out of hell free card, and they think, well, that's it. I'm done. I don't really have to do anything else here. No, God has created you for good works. Romans 8, 28 and 29. How many know the verse? Well, you know it now. It's on the screen, right? And we know, very familiar verse, and we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. Listen to 29. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his son. You see, God's design for you, God's desire for you, the way that you get into God's will and find contentment is to be constantly, moment by moment, conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. As you're conformed to the image of Jesus Christ, listen, if you put on some fireman uniform, right? You got the hat, you got the big heavy yellow coat, you got the hose, you know, you got the boots, you got everything on. You've seen this even with little kids. What do they start to do? They start to act like a fireman, right? The more you act and put on Jesus Christ, the more you're like Jesus Christ. You know what happens to you? Naturally, you perform good works. You perform good deeds. It's just a natural part of being more like Christ. You were created for it. You see, too many Christians get hung up on what God wants them to do rather than who God wants them to be. Are you worried about what God wants you to do this morning? That's not a bad thing. But the most important thing is to worry about who God wants you to be. As you become more and more like his son, Jesus Christ, you're able to figure out what God wants you to do. God's work is to make you more and more like Jesus. If you pursue being like Jesus, you will be walking in God's will. Amen? You need to ask yourself the question this morning. Am I walking in God's work? There's a way to know that. Are you walking according to Christ's precepts? Am I walking according to the Word of God? If you're walking according to the Word of God, are you becoming more and more like Jesus Christ? How does that flesh out in a real everyday situation? Tell me, church, how does it happen? Just presto bango? You sprinkle a little fairy dust on your Christian head and all of a sudden you start to look like Jesus? No, when the struggles and the trials of life and the daily things of life happen to you and you sin, do you continue in the sin? Or do you say, no, no, no. I have a purpose. I have a call. I am supposed to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. I repent from the sin. I turn from it and I head towards the things of God. Or maybe there's a situation to do good in your life and you think, well, how does this really apply in terms of making me more like Jesus? You're given the opportunity to do good for someone. Remember that old bracelet, WWJD? What would Jesus do? It's moment by moment, every single minutia part of your life, analyzing, looking at, and saying, am I more like Jesus in this? Or do I need to become more like Jesus in this area? Am I walking in God's work? Number three, guideposts. After you've walked in God's word, after you're walking in God's work, you need to walk in God's gifts. Walk in God's gifts. Would you say that with me? Walk in God's gifts. This is a good one. I'm going to ask the ushers if they would get up at this time. There are some handouts that I want to give to you this morning, and I'll give them a little time to get it as I continue to preach. But I want us to also look at Ephesians 4, 7, and 8. As they get these documents, I'll share to you what they're about here in a moment. Ephesians 4, 7, 8 says, "But to each one of us grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it says, when he ascended on high, that is Jesus, he led captive a host of captives and gave..." Guys, you guys got to wake up today. Come on, let's get that. We got to stand up. Let's go, all right? "He gave to men." That means when you became a believer in Jesus Christ, you received at least one gift, a spiritual gift. Some of you have multiple gifts. These sheets that we're handing out right now, I want you to know, I hope you'll take them home. Everybody get one, okay? Because I don't want you to share, because I want you to write on them when you get home. I want you to study them when you get home. I just wanted to put in front of your eyes, this is not comprehensive. This is not exhaustive. It's simply a spiritual gifts list. Everybody get one? Everybody? Make sure you get one for yourself, every single person. I want you to go home, and this is what I want you to do. I want you to either circle or checkmark the gifts that you believe that you have. Read the definition, read the description, and then go home and say, "Is this me?" Check it or circle it. Some of you might find one. Some of you might find multiple. Be honest. Listen, don't share this with anybody else initially, okay? Because I don't want you to say, "Well, I don't have that one. Maybe I should circle that one so I look a little better," right? Our human tendency tends to do that, right? Be honest with yourself. Evaluate yourself. This is not exhaustive. Like I just said, there are some scriptures in your notes that you can go to. You got to do this hard thing called, you ready? It's a four-letter word. W-O-R-K. We hate it in this culture. You got to do some work to find your spiritual gift. It can begin right here. Something as simple as going through this piece of paper, these two sheets, saying, "What gifts do I have?" Do you want to know your gifts this morning? Would you say amen? You see, it's paramount to being in the will of God. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, it's paramount to walking in the will of God. Your gifts will illuminate God's will. Do you know that? God especially designed you in such a way as a believer in Jesus Christ, when you've trusted in Him and He gave you those gifts, the way that you walk in His will is you walk in His gifts. And the gifts will illuminate the will. Let me give you a for instance. Maybe you can teach. Maybe you can preach. What do you think the will of God's will is for you? You teach and you preach. It might not be a profession. It might not be your only career. But you have to find ways to do that gift. Because if you don't do that gift, you won't have contentment. God has put it in you to find contentment in doing His work and His will with His gifts that He has given to you. You think about those who teach. You think about those who are encouraging. The person that has the gift of encouragement gives comfort in times of trials. How many of you guys have that gift? You know you have that gift of encouragement. Don't be shy. Go ahead, raise your hand real high. Now the question is, are you using it? Are you using it every day of your life? Are you using it? And here's a key part, and we'll get to this in a second. Are you using it in the body of Christ? Because your gifts were meant for the body. Yes, they're meant to benefit your community and friends and relatives and others, but the gifts are meant to build up the body of Christ. The gift of service is practical help to those in need. How many of you have that gift? Diane, I just lifted off two of your gifts, probably three. That's pretty cool, right? And I see those gifts evident in Diane's life. Why? Because she's using them. The question is, are you using the gifts that God has given to you? If you're not, listen, are you listening? Say amen. Amen. If you're not, I'm going to make a very bold statement. You're not in the center of God's will. It's that simple. You see, God will bless you. God will prosper you. God will encourage you in the gifts that He has given to you. You think about when you were little and you used to walk around in your parents' shoes. I need a really young kid to be an example for me. Anybody want to volunteer? Mitchell, come on. Owen, you want to do it? Owen's closer. Sorry, Mitchell. This time we'll have Owen come on. Come on, Owen. No? Come on, Macy. Macy, come on up here. All right, just stand right there at the base of the steps, and I want you to put these shoes on. These are Pastor Dave's shoes. They're a little stinky. Don't worry. Go ahead, take your sandals off. If you can get them on, the best you can, all right? All right, now, good?
Yeah.
Good. Back up for me. All right. Run as fast as you can right here and touch my hand. Go. Don't fall. Okay, good job. Good job. She did good. Give her a hand. Run back real quick. Is it falling off? It was falling off a little bit. Why is that?
Because they're too big.
They're too big, right? Because who were those shoes for? You saying I have big feet? You can take them off. Thank you. Give her a hand. You see, what happened is sometimes we try to wear the shoes of other people. We try to wear the gifts of other people because we look at our gifts and we say, I don't really care for that gift. I want that gift. I like that gift a little better. And what happens is we get clumsy and we get tripped up and we do things slower and we don't walk in God's will. Because we're trying to do and live in somebody else's shoes. It doesn't work. You have to know your gift and then walk in your gift or gifts that God has given to you. Are you walking in the gifts that God has given to you? That's the question you need to ask this morning. Am I walking in God's gifts? Number four, walk in God's body. That sounds weird, right? What? What do you mean walking God's body? How do I get, God the Father doesn't have a body. He's in spirit, right? How do I walk in God's body? You walk in God's body, if you'll turn with me, if you're not already there, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, we're gonna see what we mean by God's body. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning in verse 12, if you're there, say a hearty amen.
Amen.
It says, for even as the body is one and yet has many members, and all the members of the body, though they are many, are one body, so also in Christ. Verse 13, for by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Verse 14, for the body is not one member, but many. If the foot says, because I am not a hand, I am not a part of the body, it is not for this reason any the less a part of the body. And if the ear says, because I am not an eye, I am not part of the body, it is not for this reason any the less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? You see, God has given us a body to be a part of. And each person in this room that's trusted in Jesus Christ is part of the body. Everybody raise your hand. Some of y'all are hands. Everybody raise your foot. No, I'm just joking. Some of y'all are stinky feet, right? No, some of y'all are good feet. What do the feet do? The feet carry the message of the gospel. Blessed are the feet of those who bring good news. Some of y'all are ears, some of your eyes, some of your fingers, some of your toes, some of your... We won't go there, right? You see, God has given you a part in the body. And whenever you're not a part of the body and not bringing your spiritual gift, it makes an incomplete body. When you live apart from the body of God, when you live apart from the body that God has designed for you, you listen and say amen. You suffer. You're discontent. You're unhappy and you're thinking, why can't I find God's purpose in my life? It's because you're not a part of the body. You're not using your gifts in the body. Just as God has given you a physical body, everybody in here have a physical body, say amen.
Amen.
Some of y'all are transcendental, whatever, you're those people, all right? You have a body. Just as God has given you a spiritual body, he has given you a spiritual body. And it's the body of Christ. If you're not walking in the body, you're not walking in God's will. Yeesh. That's hard to hear. If you're not walking in the body of Christ and you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you're separated from the body of Christ, you might be in God's permissive will, his general will, but you're not in God's very specific will. And you're missing out on being content. How many of you remember putting your face in one of those cardboard or plywood cutouts and there's a different body on the outside and your face is on the inside? You guys remember that? Take a look at this. Ooh, yeah. That was on vacation in South Carolina. Nikki and I were there. That's the most in shape I've ever been. Pretty good, right? That's the most blonde I've ever been, too. It's silly, right? It's silliness. It doesn't match. That's why it's funny. You can take it off there. But sometimes I wonder in your Christian life and in my Christian life and in the life of the church, if the world doesn't look on and see the head is Jesus Christ, and a very mismatched body. Perhaps an arm missing, a leg missing, something looking deformed. You see, we are to match our head. The body of Christ is to match the head, but if you don't imply your spiritual gifts, if you don't cultivate your relationships in the body of Christ, it ends up looking funny to the world. We are to love one another, be with one another, serve one another with our spiritual gifts. When we do that, the world looks on and sees a complete body with the head of Jesus Christ, and they think, wow, that's amazing. I want to be a part of that family. Amen? The question you and I need to ask this morning, church, is, am I walking in God's body? Not your neighbor, not your spouse, not your kids, not anybody else. Am I walking in God's body? The guideposts so far have been, am I walking in God's word? Am I walking in God's work? Am I walking in God's gifts? Am I walking in God's body? The last, number five, am I walking in God's love? Walk in God's love. You want to find the will of God in your life, you need to walk in the love of God. Ephesians chapter 5 is on the screen, verse 1 in the first part of 2. It says, therefore, read it with me. You guys ready? Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children and walk in love. You want to be in the center of God's will? Do the first four things. And I want to stress, listen, many of you say, yeah, I do that a lot. I love people. I love them to the nth degree. And man, that's what I do. And I don't really have to worry about all those other things. Listen, the first four, walking in God's word, walking in God's work, walking in God's gifts, and walking in God's body, culminates in walking in the love of God. You do those first four things, and the natural desire of your heart, the natural desire of your being, what you'll want to do is express the love of God to those around you. Amen? As you study the Word of God, as you begin to do the work of God, and as you begin to become more like Jesus Christ, as you begin to discover your spiritual gifts, it gets exciting in your life. You thought, I never knew I could do this, but I can do it because God's given me the gift. And through the Spirit of God, you go out and you begin to act upon these things. And you do it in the body of Christ. And you see God change lives. That's love. That's godly love. Giving up your time, your effort, your energy, your money, your strength, your gifts for the body of Christ, for the believers, and for people in your community. It's not regulated just to the church, but it starts in the church. Let me ask you this. How do you love God? How does the Word of God say you love God? John 14, 15 gives us the answer. If you love me, Jesus said, you will keep my commandments. Don't say you love God and then ignore this book. Don't say you love God and live willfully in sin. I'm not saying you have to be perfect. Everybody stumbles. Everybody sins. But your heart's desire should be to do the will of God, should be to do the commandments of God, should be to keep the Word of God above everything else in your life. Let me ask you another question. How do you love other people? Ephesians 5, chapter 2 gives us the answer. Anybody know it? Love like Jesus. Just as Jesus loved, the verse goes on to say. It goes on to say how he loved sacrificially, giving his life up for you and for me. That's how we're to love others. Do you see the progression? Do you see if you're in the Word of God? And then if you're in the work of God, that is being conformed on a moment-by-moment basis. Listen, it's hard to be being conformed to God's will when you're driving in the car, right? You're driving in the car, and some nincompoop cuts you off, right? About takes you out. And maybe your kids are in the car, or maybe they're not. Maybe your wife's in the car. Maybe it's just you. And you think, how dare they? And you react viscerally, and you just react initially with anger. And maybe you've gotten out of the car before. Maybe you've given them that one special sign that some of us have given before, right? You act ungodly. But you see, when you go throughout life and you moment by moment are trying to be conformed into the image of Christ, those things should pass away. Those things should pass away. Not saying you won't have any sin in your life, but it should be less and less and less as you dig into the Word of God, as you dig into who God wants you to be, as you understand your spiritual gifts, as you become conformed to the image of Jesus Christ, you begin to walk in the love of God. If you're not loving God, and if you're not loving people, then you're not in God's will, and you will never find contentment. Galatians 6:2 says, bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. What is the law of Christ? He made that very clear. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the second commandment is like unto it. Love your neighbor as yourself. The law of Christ is love. Are you helping bearing the burdens of the people in this church, of your Christian brothers and sisters in Christ, and even of people who are not in this church? People who need Jesus Christ. The last question is not on the screen. I want you to go to the last slide, Doug, the very beginning one, actually, so we can stay on point from my perspective. It's not in your notes. It's not on the screen. But I believe it's the most important question of this morning. Something we've already asked. Am I walking in God's will? How do you know? You have 5 sure guideposts this morning to tell you whether or not you're walking in God's will. Any moment you diverge from one of those guideposts, you diverge from the path of God's will in your life. What will you do this morning? Maybe you're here this morning and you say, well, I don't really understand some of this. And maybe it's because you haven't come to the first guidepost that you need to come to, and that's simply this. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Jesus is the way. We're talking about paths. We're talking about the will of God. We're talking about searching through woods. The spiritual path to life eternal, to having a relationship with God, the Bible says, God has said, Jesus has said, there is only one path, one way, and that is Jesus Christ. If you've never acknowledged that, if you've never bowed your knee and trusted in Him as Lord and Savior, repented from your sin, believed that He is God, believed that God raised Him from the dead and trusted in Him, you're not even close to the will of God. In fact, you're on the anti-path of the will of God, and you're headed to a place called hell. That's what the Word of God says. Have you settled that in your heart this morning? Have you settled that in your life? That's the first step on finding the will of God. And finding contentment. Would you bow with me this morning?